Okay. We just need to make sure this. Spotlight for everyone. Okay. Okay, we are live and we are live on Facebook. So welcome everybody. And at this point, I'm going to be leaving here.
So he says she's very sheepish. So good morning to everybody and welcome to our Creef and Dundee service this morning. Pastor Jimmy has been called to preach for the Stockport Church down in England this morning. So you are going to be blessed by Pastor Robin Riches this morning. So before we get started, let's invite the Holy Spirit to come and be with us and our proceedings this morning. Please bow your heads with me. Gracious Heavenly Father, we've had some technical difficulties this morning, but we thank you for all of those that are joining us on Zoom this morning and those that will be joining us on Facebook. And as we are recording this to then later stream to YouTube, we pray a blessing on those who will be able to watch it later. May the Holy Spirit come and now be with us, calm our hearts, calm our minds, that when we listen to your word, may we hear the special message that you have prepared through Pastor Riches this morning. Bless us in a special way. In Jesus' name, amen. So yeah, usually we would have our testimony time this morning, but obviously we haven't had one this week. So this is a gentle reminder to all of those out there who, if you have a testimony that you would love to share with everybody, then please do get in touch. That can come directly to me via WhatsApp or email, or it can go directly to Pastor Jimmy, again, using any social media form, or again, through email, if you have his email address. His email address for those is jim, J-I-M, at adventist.scot. So thank you very much for those who have shared their testimonies with us, and we look forward to hearing from you soon. And also a big thank you to those of you who have been able to give your tithes and offerings. We know that this is a difficult time, and this, especially when money is a bit tight, we thank you that the Lord has been blessing you and that you have been able to give where you can. If you need any details, they are in the newsletters that get sent on a Friday to both the Creef and the Dundee congregations. But again, if you're stuck, then do send us a message and we'll be able to help you there. So we're going to have our scripture reading now, and I'm just going to try and get that to our screen quickly. So if you can bear with me. I know that it was here. There we go. And I'm just going to share screen. And our scripture reading this morning is from Naomi in our Dundee church, Naomi Majende. So thank you very much.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Today I'll be reading from Hebrews 11, verses 5 to 6. By an act of faith, Enoch skipped death completely. They all looked over and couldn't find him because God had taken him. We know on the basis of reliable testimony that before he was taken, he pleased God. It's impossible to please God apart from faith. And why? Because anyone who wants to approach God must believe both that he exists and that he cares enough to respond to those who seek him. Amen.
Thank you very much, Naomi. An interesting verse there, and we'll be learning a little bit more about that. So now it's time for our children's time. So if the children are there, please come closer to the screen. We've got something interesting for you today. Today I have with me a piece of styrofoam and a strand of spaghetti. Now, what can we learn from a strand of spaghetti? Well, I love pasta, and I'm sure those of you out there love pasta too. But what has pasta and all of this got to do with our service today? Well, have you thought about it? how strong is one strand of pasta? Is an easy way to test it. You stick it in your polystyrene thing. And I know it's very difficult to see, so I'll hold it up a little bit higher so you can see here. And it's right in front of my face. If I had to take it and put some pressure on it, let me move out the way so my white coat is not in the place. If I had to put some pressure on it, it would snap very easily. Pasta is not that strong. And you know what? If we try and do things alone, we're not that strong either. Now, the verse that we were hearing from Naomi was talking about a man called Enoch. And Enoch had immense faith. Now, what is faith? Well, faith is something that you and I experience every day, and we don't even know it. So when you come and sit down on a chair at school or at home, you have faith that that chair is going to hold you. When you wake up in the morning, you're breathing. It's something that happens without even thinking about it. And faith is something that grows. Faith is something that happens the more you see something that is good, something that is trustworthy, the more you experience faith. You know that it's going to happen. And so Enoch had immense faith in God. And there were other members in the Bible that had faith as well. We know about Abraham. We had Noah. We had so many. So how can we demonstrate, how is it that we too can have faith? Well, for this, I'm going to make some magic. And I'm going to bring some more pasta into the story. So when we have our pasta and we have these experiences where we learn to trust things more and more, and we learn to trust Jesus in all the things that we've asked him for, then it somehow becomes stronger. And I can put my weight on my hand down on these bits of pasta, and they stay. Now, how strong do you think this pasta could be? Well, for that, I'm going to turn around quickly. My Bible was here, so bear with me just a second. I do apologize. That's what happens when your lovely husband moves things around. But I have my Bible here, and we're going to see how strong this pasta is. So if I add another sheet on here, you can see it's a bit wonky, but nevertheless, I'm going to hold it just to steady it. And then I'm going to add this Bible on top. All right, there we go. And again, I'm not holding it. I'm just supporting so that it doesn't go down. Do you see how strong pasta is when it is grouped together? And this is what we can explain what faith is. A single strand, it's good. But the more you experience your faith, the more you exercise your faith, the more you trust in God, the stronger your faith becomes. And the more you surround yourself with people as well who have such faith, the stronger we become. So I want you to try this at home. See how many strands of pasta that you can put in, and see what you can balance on them. And if you get it right, do send me a picture or a video. I'd love to see how you got on. So again, I'm just holding it with one hand and it slips off, but it didn't break. How precious is that? So that's what I wanted to share with you today. And I do hope that you enjoyed it. So I'm going to now disappear. And before that, we're going to ask if there are any prayer requests. If you do, I would kindly ask that you pop them into the chat and we will remember them as we went to go into our prayer time before Pastor Richards shares the message with us. So please feel free just to pop your prayer requests into the chat if you have any. All right, so thank you very much. I'm going to say a prayer and then we will go through to Pastor Richards. I'm just going to make sure there's those coming in are muted. All right, so we have a request to kindly pray for Pastor Johnny's sister and daughter from the Dundee Church. And we have Donna to ask for prayers of her brother Colin, who is unwell. And we're thinking of our young people. Yes, absolutely. Our teens and our young children. Absolutely. We're thinking of Mason. I'm thinking of all those in my class and also in Auntie Angela's class. We're thinking of Violetta, Liana's sister, who has coronavirus at this time. Very sorry to hear that, and we will certainly pray for them. So keep them coming, and I will ask you if you could bow your heads while we pray together. Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne, there are requests that we would like to bring to you. But first of all, we want to praise you. We want to thank you for that opportunity you've kept us safe through this week, that we can come before you humbly and appreciative of everything that you have provided to us. We thank you for Pastor Richards, who will be sharing the message with us today. We thank you for those that have recovered from coronavirus and those who are on the road to recovery. We think of Lorraine and Malcolm. We thank you that they are here and that their injuries are slowly but surely being better. Dear Lord, we bring these requests to you this morning. We think of Pastor Elder Johnny's sister and her daughter. You know the situation that is happening there. And I know that his family are thinking of moving here to Scotland. May your will be done, dear Lord. We think of Donna's brother, Colin, who is unwell. Heavenly Father, you are the great physician. May you put your healing hand on them, as well as Violetta, Liana's sister. We pray for her too, as she is recovering from coronavirus. And dear Lord, we thank you for our young people. We thank you for our teens, and we thank you for those that are in our primary and junior classes. We think of Mason. We think of each one. Dear Lord, I pray for the little minds, their young minds, as they are still trying to absorb everything that has happened in the last year and a bit. And it is a challenge. We dedicate them to you this morning, dear Lord. And as we go now and leave into our time together, may you be with us, dear Lord. Amen. So thank you very much. And I am now going to give over to Pastor Richards, and he will share with us a message for today.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's a little strange. On my screen, I am speaking to myself. Not used to doing that, but I know that you can hear. I must thank Cedrine for that experiment. I must admit that she's very brave, braver than I would have been to try something like that. Apart from faith, my Bible tells me, so does yours, apart from faith, it is impossible to please God. I want to ask you this morning, how would you describe your faith right now? I invite you to examine with me three stories found in the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapters 13, 14, and 15. We'll start with the story in Matthew 13. Jesus is making a visit to his hometown of Nazareth. It's his first visit since his baptism. It's a Sabbath morning, and he joins with former friends and neighbors in the local synagogue. And as he enters, all eyes turn on him, a local boy who is making a name for himself. And not too many people from Nazareth had ever done that. As he enters the synagogue, he acknowledges his boyhood friends with a smile, with a wave of the hand, and acknowledges greets their parents with respectful nod of the head. The synagogue leader asks him to read the scripture for the day, a short passage from the book of Isaiah, which foretells the coming of the Messiah. He stands up to read it, and when he is finished, he closes the scroll, hands it back to the attendant, and then sits down and begins to comment on that passage. And as the people listen, they're all amazed at his knowledge and the depths of his insight. And then as they listen, to their astonishment, they hear him say, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." And he is finished. But the whispering, the hearers have not finished. The whispering begins. Did you hear him say that he was the Messiah? He's no Messiah. He's just the illegitimate son of the village carpenter Joseph, born out of wedlock to Mary, his mother. He's a nice lad, top quality workman, honest and trustworthy, to be sure, but he's just another village man, like us, working hard with his father to make ends meet, keep food on the table. And as the Message paraphrase puts it, they got their noses all out of joint. Now, of course, they'd all heard the rumors. They were on everyone's lips. News from Capernaum, reports from the other side of the Galilee, amazing miracles, astounding news verified by respectable people. But on the other hand, the Pharisees accused him of breaking the Sabbath, even of claiming to be the Lord of the Sabbath. They went so far as to say he was the devil, Beelzebub himself, performing miracles. And they should know, surely. And even John the Baptizer, his cousin, had his doubts about him. And soon the whispers turned to loud and angry shouts. And Matthew sadly records that Jesus could not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. See, they were a no-faith people. The Messiah? Absolutely not. But think about it. There was enough evidence for faith to take root and grow. They simply chose not to believe. They chose rather to listen to the voices of their leaders, the Pharisees, the people who led them in their religious devotions. The critics must be right, because they were simple people, and who were they to argue with the famous and the knowledgeable? And Jesus marveled at their unbelief, their lack of faith. Now, that's not so different from our world today, is it? We all live in a world of no faith people. They're all around us, the media, the educational institutions. The Bible today in our world is held up to ridicule as a book of myths and fable. Miracles, so we are told, are made up stories no better than fairy tales. Now, to be sure, Jesus is still acknowledged as a good and a great person who lived and left an example for everyone to follow. But we must remember, he died as we all do. Resurrected? No, absolutely not. A future eternal life? Again, no. Death, the grave, ends it all for all of us. But there is, even today, sufficient evidence to encourage faith. There are firm reasons for any of us to believe in this carpenter from Nazareth who changed our world. And we too must choose either to listen to the voice of God in his word, or listen to the multitude who speak against it. It's so easy for any of us to follow the majority and go along with those whom we see as being maybe more knowledgeable than ourselves, and so ignore all the evidence that is there. Let me ask you, who do you listen to? Who has your confidence? Who do you have faith in? The classrooms of the world, or the classroom of the Word of God? So let's go to the next chapter, Matthew chapter 14. We have another story to challenge our thinking there. Jesus had just miraculously provided food for 5,000 hungry people. And as the disciples were gathering up the crumbs, the bread that was left over, some in the crowd made a move to make Jesus king, reasoning that if he could feed a crowd as large as that with just two bread rolls and five small sardines, he could certainly feed an army and lead it successfully against the Romans. Realizing what was happening, Jesus immediately ordered his disciples to get into their boat and return home to Capernaum. He knew that if they stayed any longer, they would surely join with those who were involved in kingmaking. And that's where our story begins. The sun had dipped to the horizon as the disciples set their sail to catch a steady breeze blowing from the east. They made good progress until a storm blew up, one of Galilee's sudden and dangerous changes of weather. And the disciples, accustomed to these changing moods of the lake, looked at one another with concern. The surface of the sea became restless, spray whipped up from the heightening waves, and rain lashed down from a blackened sky, and with a sudden roar, the wind filled the small sail and sent the boat racing out of control. This was to be no ordinary storm. They knew that. With the waves rising ever higher and the wind howling out its anger against the little boat, they dug in their oars in desperation. And so they struggled in a frightening fight to stay afloat for hour after hour. It was around 3 o'clock in the early morning. Now exhausted and with little hope of survival, ready to give up the battle with the storm, they saw a form walking on top of the waves. Looked like a man, but it could not be. No fisherman or any other man could possibly walk on water. It must be a spirit. And the fear of the storm gave place to a greater fear of this ghost. Seeing their terror, Jesus, and of course it was Jesus, shouted out above the wind, "Take courage, it's I, don't be afraid." And Peter, his rash but lovable disciple, not sure but hopeful, shouted back, "If it really is you, command me to come to you." Jesus replied, "Get out of the boat then and come." Peter, without thinking, forgetting the storm, climbed out of the boat and began to splash towards his friend. On the water, over the waves. Now, we don't know how many steps he actually took. We don't know if he walked with confidence or walked like a baby taking its first step across the room to get to its mother, arms outstretched, taking one shaking but determined step after another. We don't know how he walked. It wasn't long, however, before he again noticed the waves, felt the wind on his hair and the spray on his face, and saw the wild movement of the boat. He suddenly realized where he was and what he was doing. He was walking on water in a storm, and he was outside the boat, and he panicked. And who of us wouldn't? And taking his eyes away from Jesus, he immediately began to sink, and he called out, "Master, save me." Jesus caught his hand and guided him back across the raging sea to the boat. And the record says, when they were safely back in the vessel, the wind ceased, and immediately they were at the land where they were going. Now, that's a great story. But what I particularly want us to notice is what Jesus said as he lifted Peter from the waves and as they both walked together back to the boat. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" Now, it seems to me that was very hard on Peter. A little faith? But it was big enough to get him out of the boat, but it was not strong enough to stand up to the storm. It was a little faith, but it was not a lasting faith. You see, Peter just the afternoon before had experienced, had taken part in the feeding of the multitude. He'd earlier seen Jairus' daughter brought back to life. He'd seen demons cast out. He had faith, and at times that faith was full of hope and certainty. Until perhaps this real personal test came to him. When for a moment he shifted his gaze from the master to the waves and the wind and lost sight of the one who had called him out of the boat. And his faith faltered. You know, we're all like Peter, experiencing times of faith and times of doubt, aren't we? We've all had to say to Jesus at one time or another, I need help with my unbelief. When the sun is shining, it's very easy for any of us to say, we believe. But when the storm comes and the gale howls, the personal test that will surely come to us, what then? I'd like to suggest that a little faith is an untested faith. Maybe even a borrowed faith. You know, many of us as Christians, many have a borrowed faith. They may not even realize that. Borrowed from their friends, borrowed from their fellow members of the church, or even borrowed from the pastor. It is their faith and not ours. Think about that. Most little children have a faith borrowed from their parents, and we can fully understand that. But there comes a time when we all have to live by our own faith, a personal faith that comes from a day-by-day walk with God and often leads us to failure and struggle, eventually to victory. Perhaps your faith is like Peter's, a little faith. Well, you can take heart from that. Even a little faith gains God's attention. But none of us really knows what sort of faith we have until it is tested. Because it is in testing that faith becomes ours and grows. And that, I believe, is why tests come. God brings them, God allows them to come to us. But we run away from tests at times, don't we? I know I have. We call for help. And when it comes, our faith flourishes. But what if it doesn't come? When nothing happens, when God is silent, what then? A little faith at that point may let go. It may give up as it did for Peter. But the good news is, of course, that when little faith is tested, even by little things, it will grow. Let me try to illustrate this. How many of you need to lose weight? And how many of you have tried again and again and have failed again and again? I have that problem. You can't see below my shoulders, I know. Anyone who has tried to lose weight finds that it is very difficult. We do well for the first few days of trying. Then visitors come and they leave a box of chocolates. And how do you say no to a box of chocolates? And then for Sabbath lunch, there's that tempting but deadly double cream-filled dessert with strawberries decorating the top and ice cream on the side of the plate. And we have learned, haven't we, since childhood, some of us anyway, we have learned that we should always have something special for Sabbath. And then maybe we come back from prayer meeting and remember we haven't had supper and we stop at the chip shop for a 9 o'clock snack. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? We try and we try, but fail so often. Self-control seems to abandon us. What we lack, of course, is willpower, isn't that right? I say, I am not going to eat any more of that food ever again. But I do. I keep eating those chocolates. Just cannot say no to a good curry. And the weight stays on. I even pray about it. I ask God for help, but no help seems to be coming. Just the other day, I was complaining again to him, asking why he wasn't listening to my prayers, complaining that he was not helping me. A little voice sounded in my head. You know, God does talk back sometimes, if we would only wait to listen. And that little voice said, now, just wait a minute. I'm doing all I can. I've been trying. The problem is not me, it's you. And it dawned on me that those chocolates, that trifle, those chips, were all tests. Tests God brings to help build up my willpower. He's been on my side all the time, answering my prayers for help. And I had failed the tests he had allowed to strengthen my will. Now, only through testing can our wills be strengthened. Only through testing can our faith grow. And so the trials that come to us from time to time are the very things that increase our faith, if we allow them to. When they come, thank God for them. Welcome them. And hang on in faith. Sometimes, the hymn says, sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes it takes a troubled sea. And sometimes it takes a desert to get hold of me. And that leads me to the last story found in Matthew chapter 15. A heathen lady has come to Jesus with a request. And Jesus doesn't respond right away. He's testing her faith. And when she has faced those tests and overcome them, Jesus turned to her and said, "Lady, great is your faith." The people of Nazareth were a no-faith people, and it amazed Jesus. Peter had a little faith, and it disappointed Jesus. This heathen lady had great faith, and he marveled, wondered at her. Now you know the story well. Jesus had traveled outside Israel to the region of Tyre and Sidon. He'd hardly arrived when a Canaanite woman came down from the hills and pleaded with him, "Master, have mercy, help me. My daughter is afflicted by an evil spirit." And Jesus ignored her. He turned his back on her. She kept on asking. He kept on ignoring her. He said nothing, not a single word. And the disciples, emboldened by his silence, said out loud so she could hear, "She's not one of us. Get rid of her. She's troubling us. Take care of us. She doesn't belong to us anyway." And shockingly, in response, Jesus said to them, replied, I've got my hands full anyway with dealing with the lost sheep of Israel. That's all I can handle. And she hears what he said, but comes back and back one more time, begging on her knees, "Please, please help me." And at last he turns to face her and he speaks to her and he said, "Would you take your children's food and throw it to the dogs?" That's the final insult, the ultimate rejection. You see, in our day, we do not realize just what an insult that was. In this country, we love our dogs. We pamper them. We pay great amounts of money for insurance and medical care. We let them sleep on our beds, and some of us even let them sleep in our beds. We give them the softest rugs in front of the fire on a cold winter night. My son-in-law tells me that in his house, the dog came first, then the children, and he last of all. Dogs, you see, rule in our world today, but not in that part of the world, not then and not even now. In those days, dogs were kept to get rid of the rats. They were scavengers. They were there for village boys to use as target practice, to be kicked, to be beaten, stoned, cursed. And this widow lady listens and understands that he is calling her a dog, one of those vermin-filled animals slinking cowardly away with tail between its legs. Her child no better than a dog? That's what she understands in the saying. And that's enough to drive her away. It would have driven me away. But she quickly and unbelievably responds, "You're right, Master. But I may be a dog in your sight, but even beggar dogs get scraps that drop from the master's loaded table." And at that, Jesus gives in, as he had intended to all along, of course. He was testing her. And he said to her, as he turns to face her, "Great is your faith, lady. Your need has been met." And right then and right there, her daughter was healed. Now, let me ask you, what was it that made her faith great? Think about it. She was a despised heathen woman, despised by the Jews and the disciples. She was the focal point of their racial prejudice. Hated, excluded. In addition to that, she is poor. She has a need, a desperate need. She can't afford a doctor. There are no friends to help her. She is illiterate and is treated with indifference. There is nothing, nothing whatsoever to commend her to Jesus. Nothing except her faith. A faith that will not be put off, will not let go. She refuses to be silenced. Jesus is her only hope. She's never met him, never heard him speak. She's only heard of him from others. But faith, the scriptures tell us, comes from hearing. And she had heard much and had faith in abundance. If she's given the privilege of a dog, crumbs left over from the master's table, she is happy to be regarded as a dog. And against all discouragement, all appearances, she persists. And her faith clings on until her need is met. That is what a great faith looks like. I wonder how many of us have a faith like that. You see, a great faith believes that God is there, even though our experience seems to say he is not. A great faith hangs on even when our prayers are not answered. A great faith says, though he slay me, I will keep on trusting him. A great faith will not falter in the wildest of storms, believing that with God it can walk on water. You read Hebrews 11 again. Think about it. A great faith is ready to live in the world destitute, homeless, and friendless. It enables us to stand firm. It stands tall in the face of argument and ridicule, and it braves abuse, welcomes the chains of imprisonment, and withstands torture and even death. We, in our affluent Western society, have a problem with faith. A recent edition of the Barnabas Fund magazine, I think, explains very well why that is so. It had a report of the persecuted church in the continent of Africa, with special reference to Christians in Kenya. I'd like to read a paragraph from it as we close. It says, there is a remarkable, steadfast faith in God's goodness amongst Christians in that country. People have learned to trust God in the uncertainty of tropical disease, civil war, and hunger, and have developed an unshakable awareness of the Lord's untrustworthiness. Many Christians here live with poverty as the norm, all too often drought and famine. There is the violence of Al-Shabaab terrorists seeking out Christians to kill them. Last year saw swarms of locusts devouring crops, and a second generation, much more numerous than the first, is due to hatch their eggs this month and in May. And between the one generation of locusts and the next, coronavirus arrived. Christians there have learned to trust God for survival every day. Now notice, those of us who are used to security and plenty, and that's all of us, isn't it? Those of us who are used to security and plenty must learn that same concrete faith. And so I ask you again, as I did at the beginning, what sort of faith do you have? Maybe right now it's just a little faith. Thank God for it. It's his gift to you. But we must never be content with just a little faith, ever. We're told in Scripture that Jesus is not only the author of our faith, the little faith, he's also the finisher of our faith. He wants something more for you, far more than little faith. He wants you to have a great faith. So he will test us and test us. And when those tests come, welcome them, because the trials that test our faith most severely and make it seem that God has forsaken us are what produce a great faith. Or we'll sometimes fail and feel despair. We may want to give it all up. But we must keep on, grow in faith, learn to walk on water with Jesus. Always remember, the path where God leads the way may lie through the desert or the sea, but it is always, always a safe path. We're going to listen to our closing hymn now. I want you to think of the words as you read them, or you may be singing them. I want you to make those words your prayer. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by many a foe, that will not tremble on the brink of poverty or woe, a faith that shines more bright and clear when tempests rage without, that when in danger knows no fear, in darkness knows no doubt. May God give us all a faith like this.
That will not trip. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by every foe, that will not tremble on the brink of any earthly woe, that will not murmur or complain beneath the chastening rod, but in the hour of grief or pain will lean upon its God. A faith that shines more bright and clear when tempests rage without, that when in danger knows no fear, in darkness feels no doubt. Lord, give us such a faith as this, and in whatever may come, we'll taste and hear the hallowed bliss of an eternal home.
Let us pray. Our Father, thank you for speaking to us this morning. Grant us this faith that will never fail. May we, each of us, walk with Jesus through life and into your kingdom, where we can live forever with you. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.